who gives this incredibly beautiful young lady to this dashingly handsome young man.
I do.
Michael, receive your bride. Yes, we're here now. You may be seated. On behalf of Michael and Amber's family, I want to welcome you to our ceremony, our worship ceremony of marriage between the two of them. It is a day of great honor that we get to witness this incredible event. Now, I'm working real hard not to do a whole lot of crying already. I promise myself, because if I sweat on this technology, I might not have any notes left. But I'm so proud of both of you, as we all are, and I want to say congratulations to the families and all your work, love, prayer that you've put into these two, that they are here today. Welcome, welcome to Michael and Amber's wedding ceremony. They've asked our brother in Christ, Miguel Mendez, to come and lead us in an opening prayer.
You guys look beautiful. Can we hold hands? God Almighty, thank you so much for this day. You have placed your children before us to witness something beautiful, something pure.
Yes.
Something holy.
Yes.
God, they set the tone for all of Chicago and this world of doing it your way, Father.
Yes.
Coming to you wholeheartedly, waiting, exhibiting patience and humility, Father, on Michael's behalf. But thank you so much. Thank you for giving them the strength to say that it's possible to do it your way. Thank you for giving them the pure love. And we are excited to see little Michaels and little Ambers running around. May you bless them with many children. In Jesus Christ's name, amen.
Amen.
All right. Well, if you can all rise, they've chosen a congregational song for us to sing here. So let's praise God and celebrate with them as Theo Jr. comes and lead us in song.
All right, everybody, we're singing hallelujah, amen.
Lord, we sing your praises loud. Sing them to the stumbling crowd. Sing of Jesus and his word. Sing until the earth has heard.
We're singing hallelujah.
Sing of crosses and his blood, earthquakes, darkness, and the flood. Sing of judgment, sing of grace. Sing until we see his face.
We're singing hallelujah. Come on, y'all.
All his power, all his might, living in the church is why
we're singing hallelujah.
God is justice, God is love, God is reigning from above, God is sovereign o'er the land, nations bow at his command.
We're singing hallelujah,
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 hallelujah.
Come on, y'all. Hey,
hallelujah,
hallelujah.
Life is but a passing glance. Seek it while you have the chance. We are made of not but clay. Till we change on that great day.
We're singing.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah,
hallelujah.
We're singing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, y'all. Hey, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Come on, sisters. Sisters, ready? Come on, sisters.
Come on, sisters.
All right, brothers, y'all ready? I want y'all to sing with all your hearts. Come on. Hey, we're singing hallelujah.
Be seated. Nothing like a wedding to bring out the praising God time, right? All I can say is hallelujah. That's awesome. Well, now we're here. And there's only one thing that I like just a little bit less than seeing people become Christians. It's seeing young ones find love. So I'm all giddy and fired up. I get a little goofy. Don't mind me. I'm going to make you laugh, try to make you cry, but I'm going to be real, real. Because this is a real moment in your life right now. Trust me. Marriage is one of the most realest. Other than making the commitment to Christ, it's the most real commitment you could ever make. And today you too have shown yourselves faithful to the Lord. As you can stand here and that white dress means something. The purity in which you guys dated and came before this altar. I am so fired up and honored to be able to marry you this evening. Not many do that. I was fortunate. That's what I did with my wife. So I know the great feeling that comes from keeping it right. Right, honey? Yeah. Again, I wanted to say so much thanks to your parents, your grandmother, and everyone, and all your family, Amber, that have loved you. Tim, you know, all of you guys have loved this young girl into a grown woman, and that's awesome. And to Mark and Frantel over there, you have really loved this young man, and you have been a great part of his coming of age as well, and thank you for embracing him and loving him and getting him to this point. It's amazing. And to all of you, the church, the family that has nurtured both these two, that has been here in support and prayer, I want to thank you too this evening. This is as much your celebration as it is theirs as well, because we are all family. But we are gathered here for a holy time, here in the presence of God and the family. And we're here to join together Michael Onishile. Now, because I might mess it up later, and Amber Morris in the holy bonds of marriage. Now, marriage, unlike it's shown out there, is a holy institution. It is ordained by God. It was always to take place between one man and one woman. When the man was in the garden, and he had this beautiful estate called Eden. It was full of innocence, and he was full of supreme happiness, but he was alone. I want to share with you the story of what took place next. I'm going to be reading from Genesis. You can just listen, relax today. In Genesis 2, Then the Lord God formed a man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And the man became a living being. Now the Lord God had planted a garden in the east in Eden, and there he put the man he had formed. The Lord God didn't stop there. He made all kinds of trees grow out of the ground, trees that were pleasing to the eye and good for food. In the middle of the garden were the tree of life and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. The Lord God took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. And the Lord commanded the man, "You are free to eat from any tree in the garden." The Lord God said, "It is not good for man to be alone. I will make for him a suitable helper." Now the Lord God had formed out of the ground all the wild animals and all the birds in the sky. He brought them to the man to see what he would name them. And whatever the man called each living creature, that was his name. So the man gave names to all the livestock, the birds in the sky, and all the wild animals. But for Adam, no suitable helper was found. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. Ooh, thank goodness. And while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and then closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of man. And he brought her to the man. And the man said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man." Now that is why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh. Adam and his wife were both naked and felt no shame. See, there's a purity when a man and woman becomes with God and before God. See, God had prepared a perfect home for Adam and placed him in the midst of this beautiful garden. It had the richest and choicest of fruits. What most don't understand is the Garden of Eden was really called God's special place. Said he walked by the cool of the day. This is where God hung out. He gave the man an incredible employment there. He put him to work where there was no work needed, free from the anxiety and toil in caring for the garden, for God did. At first, man was alone, having no human associate or helper, and this just was not good. And Michael said, "Amen." Well, not only Michael, but scriptures tells us that it is not good for man to be alone. And if it's not good for man to be alone and God ordained marriage for a man and a woman, that must mean that it's not good for a woman to be alone either. You see, God knew what the greatest gift that man could have other than his relationship with him. That was the gift of a wife, of a beautiful wife to walk with him. Why did God give this incredible woman? Well, he created all the birds and the beasts and all the living creatures of the earth, but none of that beauty satisfied him. He gave him the fruits of the garden to eat upon and to enjoy, but none of that would satisfy him. See, God was noting when he wrote, when this was written, he is noting man's incompleteness and lack of perfect happiness apart from his woman. Now, let's follow this beautiful story a little longer. And God forming this woman out of man. Let's look at it in its proper relationship as it pertains to a husband and wife. Let's think about where he took this bone from. Well, we know that he did not take it from his head for her to rule over him. But he did not take it out of your feet for you to trample on her. Not from his chest for her to lead him, but not from his back to ever be left by him. But out of his side to walk side by side with him. It comes from under his rib, under his arm, so that she is protected by him, and near to his heart, so that she can be loved by him. God knew exactly what he was doing when he took that bone right from that rib, y'all. Y'all know what I'm saying. You see, when God made woman and man, he made them to be companions, to help one another walk this journey and to make it to heaven. Men and women have very important roles. Today's society has made them somewhat not acceptable. But what God did, he made these roles so important. It was more than just providing for the home, and it's more than just keeping a home. Marriage represents Christ and the church working together for the good of all that would be a part of their family. Let's read and see how this goes. Amber, I'm going to talk to you first a little bit right here. You know, ladies are first, right? Because I believe your role perhaps is the hardest role, but because it calls for great trust as you put your very life, your spiritual life, in the hands of Michael. In Ephesians 5, now I know all the fellas love this passage, wives submit to your husbands. But that's verse 22. See, there's another verse before that in verse 21, ladies.
Right.
So I'm going to help out a little bit, and let me get a hand clap if y'all like this. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ.
Amen.
And then it goes on to say, wives, submit yourselves to your own husband as you do to the Lord. Amen. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body of which he is the Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. But she submits to a godly man. She follows a man that follows God. I believe you found one. To be the greatest of companions to Michael, help him answer that call of God on his life by being that woman. You know, I talked to Amber a lot, and we had a marriage time together. And, you know, I asked my questions of what she wanted to give to Michael as his wife. And she even said similar things like, I want to help him reach his goals and to be his partner forever and to bring joy and laughter to his life. Is this not an awesome, amazing woman right here? You see, a kingdom woman will always protect her home. She will always love her husband, her home, and her family unconditionally. And she will serve and set the example just as Jesus did for his church. Now, Michael, I do think they have a little bit harder role. But you know what? Perhaps you have the most accountable role to God. Because you must make Amber radiant and get her to heaven. That's your job now.
I got it.
Now, all the other stuff is good, but God is going to say, where's my daughter? Make sure you can answer right here, Lord. She's ready for you. In Ephesians 5, further down, it says, husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle, but holy and blameless. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. You are one now. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. Now, Michael, listen to me. Kingdom man have three characteristics also. They protect that woman at all costs. They provide no matter what. And they make whatever sacrifice is needed to see to it that this young lady, and I am sure the children that will follow this day, all make it to heaven. That's a kingdom man. You see, 75% of marriages around America don't make it past the third year. And the reason being that the man and the woman are missing these characteristics. So hold on to them tight. Each one of you also must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. Now, to accomplish this, guys, this is no easy task. I like to laugh with the ceremonies, but I like to also have the seriousness on it so you know what you're doing. To accomplish this, you will need God as the center of your lives, now the center of your marriage. In Ecclesiastes, it teaches us two are better than one because they have a good return for their labor. If either of them falls down, one can help the other up. But pity anyone who falls and has no one to help them up. And if two lie down together, they will keep warm. But how can one keep warm alone? Though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves, and a cord of three strands is not easily broken. And I dare say, as long as that third strand, God wrapped around you, as long as that's not broken, neither will your marriage be broken. Michael, when I think of you, young fella, I remember when you started coming around. And I know a little bit about your life, if you know what I mean. We've had some talks, and we've been a few places. But when I think of you, these words come to my mind. Strength. A man of great strength. Honor. Such a noble man. Loyal. Loyal. Such a forgotten characteristic. And hardworking. Man, you work harder than anybody I know. Try to catch up with Michael, he working. Any time, day or night, Michael is working. And I've seen you be like that since the day you started studying the Bible and became a Christian. Amber, when I think of you, oh my God, I start crying right here. This is gonna be hard. I'm having a hard time with this one. Amber, I remember when I first came to Chicago to lead the church here. I would give Amber rides home. Me and my wife would give Amber rides home just about every midweek service or Sunday. And it was so cool dropping you off. And I would watch her go in and make sure she got in that door closed behind her and she was safe. She became my daughter right away. She really did. I'm so proud of you today. You shine so bright, Amber. You shine so bright. And when you sing,
oh my God.
When you sing, oh my God, we know your voice came from heaven itself. But you know what else? Not only does your singing light up the room, but when you look at Michael, you light up like the brightest of stars in the sky. And when I think of you, I think of very similar words. You see, I know we've had some talks. I know your background. So I think of a young woman with great strength as well, resilience. There's no quitting you. Honor as well. Honor. I know you're going to make Michael an incredible, faithful wife. Loyal. And this woman, too, just like Michael, God, she always working. We're going to have to talk about that because y'all going to have to spend some time together. Y'all can't just be working all willy-nilly all over the place, right? Y'all got to come together sometime. But what I want to say is keep on singing love songs to God, Amber. And now sing love songs to Michael. I am so proud of the two of you. One thing's for sure, this is the 68th wedding that I've been able to perform. And I've been blessed that more than 95% of them are all together. And so I'm very happy about that. But one of the reasons I believe is that I would never stand before any couple to marry them unless I believe them to be true Christians. For it's only in your trueness to God will this last both of your lifetimes. So I'm proud of you. I love you. Thank you for letting me say these words this afternoon at your ceremony. She fired up too.
She is.
That's probably going to be y'all in about a year or so, like trying to catch it. Michael will be like, come back here. See, that was just God giving you a preview, you know? That's what happens. But at this time, your other spiritual parents as well, yes. Theo and Leslie Dawson would like to come and give you a short chart.
Yes. Thank you. Love you, Corey.
I love you. I love both of you very much. So let my wife go first.
Okay, I'm trying not to cry, guys. Amber is crying. Definitely a kingdom kid. I remember her little bitty running around in the West Region in ICLC. You and Timothy, I told him that today. But the older kids, we know a little bit more, Terrence and Nikita, because they were the same age of our kids. But I want to share something. I know we've been talking a lot lately. One thing I do want to share is the same scripture that Corey chose.
Man, imagine that. Yeah.
But it's very important with my lifestyle. So that's Ephesians 5:22. He already read it. But one key thing that he said in the scripture was about to submit to your husband as to the Lord. Yeah. And so I had to basically live that life, submit as to the Lord. So I had to put Theo, he was the head of the household. He was the head of my life, and I had to trust him. One thing I do think about, because it's really tough, especially as a woman in this world where that's not acceptable. I remember, and I don't know if you guys know, but I'm a supervisor at work. And actually, I am the boss, and I am telling guys what to do. So when I get home, Theo says, so sometimes I forget to take that trigger and knock it off. I forgot all of a sudden. I walk in and I say, hey, did you do X, Y, Z? And right away he'll say, you're not at work, buddy. You're not at work. And then I'm like, you know what? You're right. I am not at work. But I have to remember that. Because for 8 hours in the day, I'm, can you go do that? I really need you to do this. I need it now, like yesterday. And then I have to turn it off at home because he's the head of the household. He is actually the leader, and I have to remember that and give him that respect. But it helps me to stay grounded, especially when he says something like something simple, Leslie, you're not at work right now, but that's okay. Yeah. Sometimes we need those little things to help us. But I'm so excited for you guys. But with submission, it's a lot. But I have some advice for you with that word submission. Amen. So how about I share them with you?
Yep.
So let me go to my phone. Okay, I'm not good at this stuff. But anyway, things to remember. So submission, of course, we know the base word of that means to submit.
Yeah.
So the S for that is, of course, submit, no matter what. So the U, we can say, for me, of course, you know I'm kind of silly sometimes, under no circumstances do you go by emotions. Oh, I'm not going to submit because I feel a certain way. You can't do that. Because what? It's called submission.
Yeah.
So you can't always go on your feelings. So B, that, you know, submission, that word with the B, means to be obedient to the scriptures. Because if you be obedient to the scriptures, you'll find it easy to submit to your husband.
Yeah.
So one other thing, the M, is to make every effort to make God your standard. So you're always going to go after persevering and making sure that you do what you need to do as a wife by being whatever you need to be in all areas of your life. So there's not pieces that we can take out. Well, I'm going to be submissive when it comes down to whenever you have kids, taking care of the kids. But when Michael needs me to do something up, I'm not going to do that. It doesn't work that way.
Yeah.
You got to make every effort all the time. Then That I had to think about the I in that. But I'm going to tell you what I think it should say. So that I means to ignore women who say that you should not submit. Ignore them. Because I've been through that a time or two.
Clap it up, fellas.
Especially in the world. Yeah. Especially at work. Because it's a lot of women, we're leaders and in the workplace, and we don't accept it.
Yeah.
I got embarrassed a few times because they don't like the fact that I submit to Theo. So the S means success in being a wife. I can't read my own handwriting. It says success in being a wife, it has to be your goal. So that means you're going to go after you. If you got to write a list or whatever you have to do, that has to be your priority. That has to be your priority.
Yeah.
Or you'll fall short in so many ways. But you have to go after, I can succeed in this. Always go to spiritual women. So spiritual women is the next one. Don't go to anyone. Go to women that you know have accomplished these things.
Yeah.
Why would you go to a single woman? How would she even know what to tell you to do? But of course, you'll go through spiritual women. And the other I, imitate Jesus' life as you walk with God. Imitate what Jesus did, and you'll get through a lot of things. And the number that O means, obviously, this man is from God.
Amen.
Obviously. So you got to remember that. Because sometimes you'll feel like, he's not from God. He ain't right. Well, I don't want to obey. I don't want to submit. But obviously, he is from God. And in that word also is to never give up on God and to never give up on your husband. And that spells submission.
Amen.
So, Michael, my charge for you is pretty much everything my wife said, but just put man in front of it. How about that? But seriously, put God first. It's number one priority in your life. Without that, you will fail. You will. In everything you do. Second, be patient. One of the things I've learned over the years, you know, one of my favorite scriptures, James 1:19, it says, be quick to listen and slow to speak.
Yeah.
Why? Because your wife will trap you. So you want to make sure you listen. What did you say, honey? Are you sure? Going once, going twice. I'm listening, honey. I'm patient, patient. And I want to think about, and the word listen, here's what I want you to do, is think about this. I'm going to give you a 10-year jump start, like I told you last night. One thing I learned, it took me 10 years to learn this, listen to your wife. The football game's on, movie, PlayStation 3, 4, 5, 6, I don't care which one is out. When she come in the room and she say, honey, I want to talk, clip, 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 everything shut, turn your phone off and say, what do you want, honey?
Come on.
That will save you. Trust me. Tons. Because if Amber walk around the house and you ask her a question and she says, yes, Michael, yes, yes, you're in trouble. It's going to take you a while. So my challenge for you, Michael, is to make sure you follow these three things. Put God first. Be patient. Listen to your wife. Even though she may be wrong sometimes, just listen. You don't always have to agree.
Yeah.
But just listen.
Yeah.
So she know that you care enough to give her your best. And when she feels secure in that area, trust me, you'll be able to get it whatever you want. Whatever. So that's the secret to marriage. We've had a great marriage the last 26 years.
Amen.
Happy marriage. I want you to have a happy marriage. As my son in the faith, I love you. Please put these few things into practice. It's not hard. It's a few things, but it's real hard for a man. Yeah. just put them into practice, brother. And I believe that you'll do far greater things than I've ever even achieved.
Okay. Yep. Come on.
Love you, brother.
Love you,
brother. Ain't Leslie the boss?
No.
Ain't she the boss at work, too?
Only
at work. All right. Anyway, I just wanted to clear that up right there. Great charge for you guys to take to heart.
Yeah.
And we've all heard it. So we're going to hold you accountable for it, too. Amen. Right now, Michael and Amber have chosen to light the individual unity candles and then light the one representing their two lives as individuals going away and them coming together as one. As they do so, they will also exchange their vows that they would like to do privately to one another at the unity candles. And then they will come before us and we'll have other vows right here with you, if we may. Singing while this is taking place is our sister Effie, who did a dynamic job at church today, along with Aisha. And she's singing a song, I Get to Love You. You guys can start making your way.
They say love is a journey,
beautiful. Thank you, Evan. I would have loved to be a fly in that little altar up there. As is my custom, I like to write vows for each couple to take before God and the witnesses here at the church. So, if both of you, first you, Michael, or Amber, I'm sorry, and then you, Michael, will repeat what I'm saying. I, Amber, take you, Michael.
I, Amber, take you, Michael.
To be my husband and faithful partner in life.
To be my husband and my faithful partner in life.
And my one true love.
And my one true love.
On this special day.
On this special day.
I give to you in the presence of God and our church family.
I give to you in the presence of God and our church family.
My sacred promise to stay by your side as your faithful wife.
My sacred promise to stay by your side as your wife.
Faithful wife.
Faithful wife.
You're not going to get done by me.
Faithful wife.
Okay. In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
In joy and in sorrow.
In joy and in sorrow.
As well as through the good times and the bad.
As well as through the good times and the bad.
I promise to love you without reservation.
I promise to love you without reservation.
And unconditionally.
And unconditionally.
To comfort you in times of distress.
To comfort you in times of distress.
Encourage you to achieve all of your call as a man of God.
Encourage you to achieve all of your call as a man of God.
To laugh with you.
To laugh with you.
And to cry with you.
And to cry with
to
you.
To grow with you.
To grow with you.
And to always be honest and open with you.
And to always be honest and open with
and
you.
And to finally cherish you.
And to finally cherish you.
As long as we both shall live.
As long as we both shall live.
Michael, your turn. I, Michael.
I, Michael.
Take you, Amber.
Take you, Amber.
To be my wife.
To be my wife.
Knowing in my heart that you will be my constant friend.
Knowing in my heart that you will be my constant friend.
My faithful partner in life.
My faithful partner in life.
And my one true love.
And my one and only true love.
On this special day.
On this special day.
I give to you in the presence of God and our church family.
I give to you in the presence of God.
And our church family.
And the church family.
Come on, I'll make sure this is real tied up. My sacred promise.
My sacred promise.
To stay by your side.
Stay by your side.
As your faithful husband.
As your faithful husband.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
In joy and in sorrow.
In joy and in sorrow.
As well as through good times and bad.
As well as in good times and bad.
I promise.
I promise.
To love you without reservation.
To love you without reservation.
And unconditionally.
And unconditionally.
To honor and respect you.
To honor and respect you.
To provide for your needs the best I can.
To provide for your needs the best I can.
To protect you from harm.
To protect you from harm.
You just got to follow me. Just repeat what I said. To comfort you in times of distress.
To comfort you in time of distress.
Grow with you.
To grow with you.
To always be open and honest.
To always be open and honest.
And cherish you for as long as we both shall live.
I cherish you for as long as we both shall live.
See, my boss put the heat on the brother boy. Now have the rings. Let's take them out. You're supposed to take them out, though. All right. There you go. May I have them? You know, the rings are circular in its description. And what it means is eternal love, meaning there's no end. So I love the symbol of marriage being the ring. So let us together pray over these rings that will symbolize Michael and Amber walking together the rest of their days. Our God in heaven, we lift these symbols up to you here. As Michael and Amber Ware of it. May their pledge to one another and their pledge to you together be for the rest of their lives. We thank you for these two. And we thank you that we can present, again, these symbols as a representation of a marriage that lasts a lifetime. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amber, I'm gonna have you start. Do I got the right one? You have the same size finger?
The black.
Okay. As you place this ring on Michael's left hand, it's that one, bro.
I know.
Repeat after me. With this ring.
With this ring.
I thee wed.
I thee wed.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
The Son.
The Son.
And the Holy Spirit.
And the Holy Spirit.
Michael, don't drop it.
Okay.
And repeat after me as you place it on her finger.
Okay.
With this ring.
With this ring.
I thee wed. I thee wed.
I thee.
Thee.
I thee wed.
I don't need to have that in Nigerian language.
Okay, I thee wed.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
And the Son.
And the Son.
And the Holy Spirit.
And the Holy Spirit.
Well, you guys have gone and really done it now. Because of what we've all witnessed, your commitment to one another, the vows you have shared here this day, and in the presence of God and these witnesses, I can now... Y'all ready? Here's Michael and Amber. With great honor, I can now pronounce you husband and wife. Michael, you may kiss your bride. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please rise? As I introduce to you, this December 17th of 2017, Mr. and Mrs. Michael Onisile. You can leave it. Uh-oh. You guys wait. Oh, go ahead, Marcus. Once again, I present to you Michael and Amber Onisile.